1, 2, 1, 2.
Amen. Hey, good morning, church. Would you stand on your feet? Would you join me as we read Psalm 136? It says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good." Amen. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Somebody say, "His love endures forever." Give thanks to the Lord of lords. For him who alone does great wonders. Thank you, Tracy. His love endures forever. Amen? How many of you are thankful for God's love this morning? Amen? Is it just me? How many of you are thankful for God this morning? If you've experienced his love, if you know that he brings things that we thought were long gone and dead to life, if you know that that's your story this morning, would you join me as we sing? Amen? My testimony from death to life.
Holy is your
know.
Who else can lead us to freedom?
You say,
no one, no one, no one.
And who else can heal all our sins and diseases?
Say,
no one, no one.
Together, just sing to him.
'Cause there will be no other God before you.
Sing.
'Cause there will be
God before you.
'Cause there is no one above, no one beside you, nobody like you. There will be no other God before. No one, no one, no one.
Amen. We know that we, when we call on the name of the Lord, when we call on his name, and we know the one that bears all authority now, his name is Jesus, amen? When we call on his name, and we say, oh Jesus, I really need you. We have to know that calling on that name has power. Amen? I'm saying there's name in the power. There's power in the name of Jesus. Amen? And God, forgive us when we call on your name and we don't do it with our whole hearts. We say, yes, I pray for this in the name of Jesus, but I'm going to go my own way right now, and I'm going to scheme my way to make this happen because I got to make it happen. But when we call on the name of Jesus, and when we call on his name, how many of you know that God works in ways where you're just amazed? You're like, there's no way I could have put this together myself. There's no way I could have schemed this. It's a God thing, right? So when we call on the name of Jesus and we say, there will be no other God before you, I will not be the God in my life. Amen? I will not put my trust in other gods like money and stability and anything that this world can offer. Amen? So together we say, there will be no other God before you, God. Amen? Amen. Hey, let's read from the Psalms one more time. And I'd love to read Psalm 42. Amen. If you want to follow me there, you're more than welcome to. And I'd like to read it to everyone here today. Cool. Why, my soul, are you downcast? I'm reading from verse 5, by the way. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Do you ever just look at yourself and you have this realization of like, dang, I'm disturbed right now. You know, I'm on shake. You don't even realize, somebody else has to tell you sometimes. You know, you're just doing your own thing and you think that, you know, you're just like focused, and then somebody else is like, yo, what's going on with you? You just gotta look at yourself and be like, my soul, why are you downcast? Why so disturbed with, put your hope in God. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Can we encourage ourselves this morning? Can we build up the faith in this room this morning? Amen? Can we do that? The Lord is my rock. The Lord is my strength. Amen? Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, oh, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We can make some internal inventory and just look within ourselves and exhort each other to once again put our hope in you. Oh God, only you know the mountains that we're facing. Only you know the valleys that we're facing right now, Lord. And Lord, we believe in what you spoke. We believe in your purpose. We believe in your plan right now, Lord. And we're gonna abide in you this morning by praising you. We will abide in you by singing of your goodness. Your love endures forever. Your goodness endures forever. So let us sing this morning.
All my life. Oh,
It's your breath.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you. Oh, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour.
Have hope. I will praise you more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, of your saving acts all day long. I don't know about you, but I can praise my God all day long. Amen. Come on. My mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, of your saving acts all day long. Though I know not how to relate to them at all. Oh God, we praise you and we exalt you. And we sing of all of your righteous deeds and every good thing that you've done. Even if we have not known that thing. Even if we haven't seen it yet. Even if we haven't seen it in our story. Because we know that you are good. And your love endures forever. Amen? Come on, if you know the God that you're praising this morning, would you lift up a shout of praise one more time for Jesus? Make it a shout of victory because we have victory in him. Amen? Amen. All of God's people said, amen, amen. Hey, love you guys. We're so glad that you're here at church this morning. I want to go ahead and invite you to greet one another. Give the person behind you or next to you a high five. Give them a hug. Say, I'm so glad that you're here. Amen.
What is up, Souls Church? Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Goodness gracious. We were, praise God, praise God. Oh, hey, good morning, what's up? TSC, I love you guys so much. I can't get up here without giving you some scripture. Can I do that for a second? Just a few verses. First, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 says this, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. If we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our suffering, so also you share in our comfort. You know, at church, we may come with a prayer petition. We may come with a struggle. We may come with something inside of our hearts. But at the same time, God gives us comfort. There are some of us that had an amazing week. What are you doing with that? Are you sharing it with those that need it? The church, we talked about it on Sunday. The church isn't just for the sick. The church is also for those that are healthy. And we are here. We're all sick. At the end of the day, we're all sick. We're all sinners. Amen. But there are some of us that are just overjoyed with what God has done in us. And we have the tendency of keeping it to ourselves or throwing it under the carpet and saying, hey, I'm full of joy, but I'm not going to share it with you. Oh, deprived me. I'm a sinner. Yes, we are all sinners. But we are also full of joy. Amen. If you have joy today, this morning, how are you sharing it with your brother and your sister? I encourage you today, TSC, as a community, to not just pray for one another, but to celebrate with one another. And if you just had an amazing worship experience, if God speaks to you through the word, and you just have this joy, do not leave without encouraging someone this morning. Can we do that? Can we do that? Amen. If this is your first time here at TSC, my name is Josh.
And I'm Tiffany.
And this is Tiffany. She is an integral part of everything we do here at TSC, and we're here to serve you however we can. If you received a bulletin and there are some cards in there, there's a blue card, there's a first-time visitor, we want to connect with you, we want to follow up with you. The white card is if you're interested in next steps. The black card is if you have prayer. We are serious about our prayer here at TSC. So please let us know, how can we pray for you? And make sure if it's your first time here to stop by the blue tent so that we can give you a gift, because we don't want you to leave here empty-handed. And we have some amazing announcements. That's why Tiff is here with me. She's going to share this time with me. So Tiff, what's going on at TSC?
So, hello? Okay, perfect. So we actually have, I don't know if everyone here has heard, but we are opening up a preschool, which is amazing news because of all of the lives that we'll be able to impact. And this coming Saturday, April 13th, is the last Saturday that we have before a really important inspection. So there is a lot to get done, and we're asking for your help. If you have a few hours that you can volunteer on Saturday, we're going to be meeting at the preschool and cleaning, putting together furniture, setting up classrooms, putting up blinds. There's so much to do before this inspection that is on Thursday. And we'll end with a prayer over the preschool and for the inspection. But if you have a few hours that you can give up on Saturday, we'll be meeting from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. and we need you. Whether it's sweeping a floor, putting up blinds, whatever you can do, trust me, there's so much to do. And it's just gonna take us that one step closer so that hopefully come this fall, we'll be able to start impacting the lives of these children and these families in our community. So if you have a second, open up your TSC app and you can click under events and sign up right there. If you don't have the TSC app, download it on the App Store. If you need help with that, find us in the black tent after service. We'll be more than happy to help you sign up. But handymen, we're talking to you. Mamas, everyone, we need you. We need you this Saturday. So if you can come out, that would be amazing. Also, if you are new to TSC, if you've been coming for a while but you want to learn more about the church, get plugged in, you just have questions, we have Power Track, which is our membership class. It'll answer every question about the church. It goes over what we believe. It goes over our spiritual giftings. It goes over so much useful information. And today is week one, and we meet right after service. As soon as you walk out, you'll see a big Power Track sign to your right hand side. So if you're interested, come and join us right after service, and our kids. Kids, it's time for you to go to Power Kids, so stand up and go learn about Jesus.
Thank you so much for all of our Power Kids teachers who are just out here making things happen. We had an amazing Easter last Sunday. A lot of people heard of Christ. We were able to talk with a lot of them, and we're just excited for what God is doing within TSC. So many dresses this morning, they're so cute. We're going to transition over to our giving, and as always, I want us to reflect on why we give. So I'm not sure how God has blessed you this week, and the fact that you are here and the fact that you were able to put some gas in your tank is a blessing in itself. So I know for a fact that everyone in this room is blessed one way or the other. The question is, who do we give thanks to? Who do we give gratitude to? Do we give thanks to ourselves? Do we look ourselves in the mirror and go, man, you're just a sharp boy making things happen, climbing that corporate ladder, boy. I mean, if that's our attitude, then hey, all power to you. You know, but at the end of the day, someone created you. Someone gave you those skills. Someone gave you the strength. Someone gave you the oxygen. You know, God isn't just up there going, well, good luck with them. Hope they're doing great. No, God says that he has you alive. He's literally keeping all of us alive because he has a purpose in our life. And if you're spending the majority of your time working, are we using that for his honor and glory? And I'm not just talking about evangelizing and being a testimony at your job, which you should be doing. I'm talking about, what are you doing with the resources that God gives you every single week, or bi-weekly, or bi-monthly, or if you're an entrepreneur, whenever something happens. God has blessed us abundantly, and this is the opportunity that we have to not just obey what it says in his word, but to also give in faith to our Father who has given us absolutely everything. And I know it might hurt. I know a lot of times we're concerned because we have to pay for groceries, or we have XYZ bill that needs to be paid for immediately. But let me tell you something, and it's something that I have lived my entire life, that whenever we put God first and we give in faith and we give in gratitude, God blesses you. He takes care of you. You know, and I'm not here to tell you he's going to double it and he's going to give you the Mercedes, or that he's going to give you the mansion, he's going to give you the $1 million opportunity. I'm not saying any of that. But God blesses you. He takes care of our needs. He is our Father. And the same way that a dad isn't going to throw a snake at their kid when they ask for something, our Father is not going to throw a snake at us. He's going to bless us. He's going to take care of us. So let's just take this time to give. Before that, let me tell you how to give. Very important. How to give. Excellent. Online app, Cash App, Zelle kiosk. There it is. We say it every single Sunday. It's there for you. We have a kiosk in the back. You can give however you want to give, whatever amount God puts in your heart. We don't tell you none of that. We just want you to know why you are giving. So let's pray and let's give this time to him. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray for everyone here. I know, Lord God, that you have blessed us abundantly, and this is our opportunity to open our hands in generosity, Lord God. You have been abundantly generous with us. We've had opportunity after opportunity. And if we sit here for a moment and we just look at all the blessings that you have given us, health, family, dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you, thank you. And I just pray, Lord God, that you open up hearts and minds today to be able to hear your voice through the word, Lord God. Receive our giving, Lord God. Multiply it. May we continue to be good stewards of this, of these funds, Lord God, so that we may continue to make an impact within our community, Lord God, through the gospel. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. And in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
morning. It's good to see all of you. This morning, I am not going to bring any goats on the stage or any of that, but I am going to light a candle. And the reason I'm going to light a candle is because I think it is extremely unique how when we light a candle, what we see is a small flickering flame. It's fire. It's beautiful. It has the potential to heat. It has the potential to warm. It has the potential to draw out stories if you've ever sat around a campfire. It has the potential to cook. A fire inside a fireplace is beautiful because it has the potential to utilize and give us warmth. But fire also has the potential to consume, the potential to burn wildly. Inside of a fireplace, it's beautiful. Outside of a fireplace on a house, it is not. It has the potential to destroy, and it has the potential to kill. And so fire has the potential for beauty, but it also has the potential to burn, which is why it's so interesting in the book of Hebrews chapter 12. We read this scripture in 27 and 28 where it says, "Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming what? Fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Fire has the potential for energy, but it also has the potential to burn, which is what we're going to be reading about in our story this morning. As we've been going through the book of Leviticus, we get to a story in chapter 10, which is just shocking to many of us. You see, fire has the ability to destroy. I remember in 1986, where I was a kid, and I heard about this story of a teacher who was going to be going to outer space. See, in 1984, NASA had a program where they were going to allow teachers to go to outer space, and there was a lottery, and 1,100 teachers applied for it, and one teacher won, and this teacher named Krista, she was so excited because she was going to bring space to her students. She was going to record and document and show her students what it meant to actually go to outer space. And she was selected by NASA, so she began to train. And she began to go through the process of months of training and conditioning in order to be able to go to outer space. And in 1986, she was ready. And the rocket lifted off. And it was beautiful, and it was an excitement for 73 seconds. Until there was an explosion, and this teacher lost her life, and many others, seven other different astronauts on that ship lost their life. And I remember that growing up, hearing about it in the news, seeing it happen, hearing about it in school. See, some of you are too young to remember that, but fire has the ability and the potential to take us to outer space, but it also has the ability to explode and destroy. And what we see in this story in Leviticus 10, and I skipped over it last week. If you notice, if we were in Leviticus 16 and we were talking about the story of two goats, verse number 1 actually says, "Now after the death of Aaron's sons." See, I skipped over that part because I didn't want you distracted in it. But now we get to it in Leviticus 10, and it actually tells us that Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, they took their censers. And they took their censers, and they were bringing the fire to God. and they put their fire in them and they added incense. So they had been trained and they had learned what it meant to be a priest, that they had to make these sacrifices. They were ready. They were in the robes. They were dressed in white. They were excited. And they took their fire and they offered unauthorized fire before the Lord, it says. And contrary to his command, they offered this strange fire. And when they had offered it to him, it tells us, contrary to his command, so fire came out of the presence of the Lord and consumed them, and they died before the Lord. A catastrophe, an accident, leaves us shocked. Like, why, God, would you consume them with fire? Why, God, would you allow them to die for offering a sacrifice? Their ordination process, their training to become a priest, lasted longer than their actual ministry. Why would God allow them to be consumed? Why does this, the sudden death, raises so many questions for us? Did they come out at the wrong time? Did they do it the wrong way? Like, why and what was going on for them to happen? Did they enter the Holy of Holies by accident? Did they go too far into the temple? Why did God allow them to become consumed? And there's a bunch of different theories on why. I'll just list out a couple of them to you. There's several different ones. Like, what's the big deal? Why did God kill them? Well, some believe it's because they didn't take it seriously. Some believe it was because of their complacency in how they actually offered the fire to God that ultimately consumed him. They are called to be different than every other nation. They were called to be different than all the other people to worship this God. And in their complacency, they just didn't seem to care. They handled their priestly responsibility with a relaxed manner. They handled it and said it's not that big a deal when it actually is. Some believe that it's because there was a power move that was going on in this passage. Notice that it was the high priest that we talked about last week that was supposed to make atonement in the Holy of Holies once a year. And because this was Aaron's sons, they grabbed the censer and they went into the holy place. So some believe that maybe they were trying to become the high priest. Like, okay, we've seen him do it. Now we want to do it. We want to be the center of attention. We want to be this person. And it was a power move to say, I can do it even better than the one who was selected to be the high priest. And so was it a power struggle going on? And that's why they were ultimately consumed. Some believe that it's because they used the fire in a wrong way, that tribes offer fire to gods, other nations, other tribes, and they just did it in a wrong manner, matching those other tribes. Like, we're not going to do it the way that God told us to do it. We're going to do it the way that these other tribes are doing it. There's a better way than what was instructed to us. We see other people doing it, and it's working for them. So maybe there's just a better way, because we see things in culture, we see certain people being blessed, and we're just going to copy what they do. And some believe that maybe that's why they were consumed. Some believe that they were actually drinking on the job. If you look at later on in verse 6, it will tell of specific commandment to Aaron, hey, when you come and offer these sacrifices, don't be drinking. Don't be drunk. Be clear-headed, be clear-minded, take responsibility and do this with reverence. Don't just be in a relaxed manner and not be clear-headed. So maybe they were being, you know, they were drinking on the job. They came and offered these sacrifices and they had been drinking too much and they came into the Holy of Holies, and ultimately that's why they lost their life. And some believe they were breaking the covenant. They were worshiping gods and taking other lovers in the sense of worshiping these other foreign gods. Regardless of why, we don't quite know the exact extent. Some translations says that they offered a strange fire. A strange fire. Some say an unconsecrated fire. So we can get the idea of the way that they offered the fire. The fire that they used was not the fire that ultimately they should have been using. We don't know what his strange fire was, but some versions of the Bible tell us that it was not God's fire. It was not the consecrated fire that God used, because ultimately they were supposed to use the fire that was never supposed to go out. There was an altar of incense. There was an altar of fire there at the beginning of the tabernacle that came out of the Holy of Holies, and God lit this altar. And they were supposed to use it every single day. Every single time they made a sacrifice, they were to use this fire. And maybe they lit their own fire. So why was it such a big deal that God would actually take their lives? Why was it such a big deal that God would actually kill Aaron's sons? And the thing is, distinctions matter. We say, was it such a big deal that they offered a different type of fire? Was it such a big deal that they didn't use God's fire? Come on, there has to be multiple ways. There has to be multiple things that they could have done. And ultimately, we say, does it really matter? And the answer is yes. You see, when you're starting something new, distinctions matter. When you're starting a new system, a new way of life, a new way of being, small details matter. Tell an alcoholic who has been sober for 40 years, oh, is it such a big deal that you don't go into the bar? Is it such a big deal that you relax? It's okay. Just have one drink. Tell an alcoholic who's been struggling with it, it's not that big a deal. And they'll say, yes, it is. And they'll use the words that this is life and death. That this is that important. That I can't just have one, because this distinction will set me on a path of destruction. So I got to have boundaries. I got to know what's right and from what's wrong. And in order to do this, I cannot do that. Tell somebody who has been getting out of debt that the employer who robs them from just a couple hundred bucks and just say, oh, it's just a couple hundred bucks. No, it's important. The small things matter, because I was counting on this paycheck. I was counting on this couple hundred dollars. I was counting on this money. And you're going to just tell me it doesn't matter? And so a lot of times we think, oh, was it that big a deal? When God is setting up new systems and new ways of doing things, small details matter, because it could set up for life or death for somebody else. The priests were supposed to be intercessors. The priests were supposed to be mediators. The priests were supposed to bring life and forgiveness and cleanliness to the people. They were the ones who were supposed to stand up in the middle of the gap between the divine and humanity and say, you are clean. I'm bringing your sins to God, and I'm bringing his forgiveness to you. I stand in the gap. I stand in the middle as God's anointed chosen ones. They were supposed to be different. So every single small detail matters, because it is life and death for the people of God. They need to be forgiven. They need to be cleansed of their sins. So every single detail matters. And it's interesting that this isn't the only place we see this. When God was beginning the theocracy of the priesthood, Nadab and Abihu end up dying because they offer unconsecrated fire. When God was beginning the monarchy and the establishment of the kingdom, there's a story in 2 Samuel 6 where Uzzah grabs the tabernacle because it one of the oxen had hit a bump in the road and it was stumbled, and he was trying to save the tabernacle, and he reaches out his hand and he grabs it. He tries to save it from falling, and instantly he falls dead. And a lot of people say, was that really fair? He was trying to save the tabernacle from falling. In fact, King David was so fearful at that point that he didn't let the tabernacle come back home to him. He sent it off, and for 3 months it was in a distant land. And God blessed and grew that land. And then King David said, okay, they're getting God's blessing, so I want to bring it back. And he brings it back to his kingdom. When Christianity was starting out and the apostles were meeting together as a church, you have the story in Acts chapter 5 of Ananias and Sapphira, who end up coming and bringing a half offering to the Lord, a complacent offering to the Lord. They're lying about the offering. They're saying, yes, we sold our house. We're giving all of it to the church because we want this popularity and this fame. And right then, because of their lie, they drop dead. Because whenever God is starting something new, the small details matter. The distinctions matter because God is starting a brand new thing. You see, God cares not just about the actions. Because even Peter at that point had looked and said to Ananias and Sapphira, he said, if you had been honest with us, you could have kept this offering for yourself. You didn't have to bring the offering. You didn't have to give it to the church. But because of your lie, you will die today. Because they lied. You see, God cares not just about the actions, but he cares also about the heart. They were offering an external offering, something good. They were bringing a tithe to the church. If they had just said, hey, we're going to tithe part of our house sale, they would have accepted it. It would have been fine. But because of their heart, it wasn't the action that killed them. It was because of the lie. It was because of their heart. It was because of their dishonesty. God cares not only about the action. They were being generous and they were giving, and that was a good action. But because of their lie, because of their intentions of wanting popularity, wanting fame, wanting to be noticed, wanting to think that they are better than they were, better than they ought, ultimately, they suffered the consequence. You see, this is what it means in Proverbs 21:22, when it says, every way of a man is right in his own eyes. Everyone is right in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the heart. The Lord weighs the heart. The Lord weighs our actions. The Lord weighs our intentions. The Lord weighs our heart. Jesus talks about this with the Pharisees. When the Pharisees were teaching against Jesus and ridiculing him, Jesus goes to the Pharisees and he begins to call them hypocrites. And in Matthew, he actually says in 23, he says, woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You're supposed to be the priests. You're supposed to be the teachers. You're supposed to be the intercessors between the divine and humanity. And he says, you are hypocrites. You're faking it. And then he tells them, you clean the outside of the cup. So you're trying to do everything perfect on the outside. You're trying to do everything that you're trying to look better than who you are. You're trying to do all the right actions. And you say, isn't that good, Pastor Chris? I'm trying to do all the right actions. He says, yes, but you're faking it. You're going through the motions. You're complacent inside of your heart. And he says, why would you clean the outside of a cup first? He said, wouldn't you clean the inside of the cup first? Because he knows your heart. He knows your intentions. He knows where your actions really come from, that you're faking it. And he begins to say, you need to clean your heart first. You need to clean the inside of the cup first. In order for your actions to really change, in order for your behaviors to change, and to be long-lasting, you need to transform and change your heart. God is not just concerned about the action. He's concerned about your heart this morning. He's concerned about the inside of you, your thoughts, your intentions, your desires. That's why the Bible says that we need a brand new heart. Our heart is deceitful. Our heart is sinful, and we need a different heart. We need to clean the inside of us. Nadab and Abihu were going through the motions of the priesthood. They were going through the actions, but they had a deceitful heart. They were faking who they were. They were dressed in the outside robes. They looked like priests, but they were acting like adolescents. They looked like God's servants, but they were acting immature. And it cost them their life. You see, sometimes we get into this habit of just going through the motions. This loss of spirituality in the routine. This loss of spirituality in the mundane. Like, is it really that important to read my Bible? Is it really that important to pray? Is it really that important to dedicate time to God? And we get busy and we get distracted. We go through the motions of coming to church and we give God a little bit of time, maybe once a month, if he's lucky. Sometimes twice a month if I'm doing really, really good. And we go through the motions. We go through the actions. But the problem comes in this, that as we're going through the motions and we're going through the actions, our heart is really dying inside because we're disconnected from the Lord. We have the wrong attitude, and we begin to slowly see it come out in other ways. I watched a video this week, and the story hit me and struck me because the mom was talking about a messy house, and she got on the video and she started to show how she puts away socks and she puts away the undergarments. She's putting away the clothes. She's washing the dishes. And it almost looks like she's going to start complaining about all the work, like, oh, my husband, he does this. Oh, the kids. And she looks like she's going to start complaining about the mess. And then she says, but I changed my attitude. I stopped in my tracks. And now what I do, instead of complaining about called to clean something up, I stop in the middle of that activity and I begin to pray. I begin to pray for my husband. I begin to pray for my children. And this one single act of prayer has changed my attitude from complaining about the mess to actually appreciating the mess. This one single act of prayer has called me to now spend time with God, going through the same motions, the same routine, but what is different is my attitude. What is different is my focus. What is different is my perspective. Because I'm not complaining about the person leaving this trash for me anymore, now I'm using it as an opportunity to pray for them. And it's growing her relationship with God, and it's giving her time to pray for her family, which is the most important people in her life. You see, it changes. Not the action, but the attitude. Not the task, but the heart behind it. If I had to say it this way, and I'll break it down to the most simplest terms possible, is that bad decisions, if you're taking notes, kill people. Bad decisions kill people. You see, the bad decision to sin ultimately equals death. The bad decisions in life sometimes we make ultimately leads to death. It kills people. And we talk about this all the time, that we say, haven't we moved past this barbaric God where he's striking people dead? Haven't we moved past this? But yet we talk about it all the time. We say things like, oh, this job is just killing me. This decision I made to get in debt is just killing me. I feel like I'm suffocating. And we talk in this language like of life and death where we're just dying. I'm being killed by this decision. It's just all of this busyness is sucking the life right out of me. I'm wasting away. We talk about this like if we disconnect from the source, then ultimately, we die inside. You see, bad decisions kill people. The decision not to read our Bible will kill us. The decision not to pray and spend time with the divine will ultimately suffocate us. The decision to not be in fellowship with God's people will ultimately destroy us. We will slowly fade away. Bad decisions, one at a time, over and over again, will eventually lead to our death and destruction. Fire has the potential to bring warmth and energy, but it has the potential to also burn and destroy. It's what Jesus meant in John chapter 15 when he says, I'm the vine. I'm the source of life. I'm what gives you nutrients. I'm what gives you life. And he says, you are the branches. You get your nutrients, your energy, everything from me. But if you remain in me, I'll remain in you, and you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do absolutely nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burn. He says, if you disconnect from the source, if you disconnect from the energy, if you disconnect from life, then there's no purpose for you anymore. You are going to wither up. You are going to shrivel up. You are going to slowly die and fade away. Because Jesus is our energy. Jesus is our source. Jesus is where we get our nutrients. Jesus is where we get our life. And if you're not spending time in a relationship with Jesus every single day, you are starving yourself. You are slowly fading. You are dying because you are not receiving the Lord's fire. You see, they used their own fire. They did not use the Lord's fire. They chose to use their own fire. One bad decision ultimately cost them their life because it was the Lord's fire that sustained their life. If you look all throughout the Bible, we see this theme of fire. Exodus chapter 3, there's a burning bush, and Moses was before the burning bush, and the bush is on fire, but it did not consume the bush, and the Lord spoke from the fire. The pillar of fire and wilderness that led the Israelites all through the desert. It was a cloud by day and a fire by night. The Lord led them with a pillar of fire. On Mount Carmel, Elijah was against 450 prophets of Baal, and he was calling down fire from heavens. And ultimately, it was fire that came down to show them who the true God was. When the Isaiah prophet was being called into the ministry, and he says, woe to me, a man of unclean lips. It was an angel that came over to the coal of fire and brought a burning coal to Isaiah's lips and cleansed him with God's fire. And now he said, go and teach and preach to the people. It was at Pentecost that tongues of fire came down to ignite that the Holy Spirit was present with God's people and that the people would go forward speaking and preaching and teaching on behalf of God, that tongues of fire were over them and it was God speaking on their behalf. And in Hebrews, we see that God is a consuming fire. You see, this theme of fire was all throughout the Bible, that God is a fire. Which is why Jesus in Matthew 3:11, he says, I baptize you with water for repentance, talking about John the Baptist. John the Baptist says, I'm going to baptize you with the water for repentance. But after me, talking about Jesus, comes one who is more powerful than I. Sandals I'm not even worthy to wear or to even carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. He will baptize you with fire. So here's my question for you. Who lights your fire? Who is lighting your fire? Nadab and Abihu lit their own fire and brought it to the Lord, and they learned the hard way that it was going to be extinguished. It was going to burn out. It was going to be a puff of smoke because they could not do it in their own strength. They could not do it in their own ability. They had to use the Lord's fire that came out from his temple. They used unconsecrated fire and it cost them their lives. So who is lighting your fire? If I said who had to put a fire in your britches, who would it be? Who has to light your pants on fire to make you move? Who has to actually light you on fire to get you to worship and bend the knee and read your word? You see, do we put the fire on the worship leader? When Josh Morales stands up here and he's trying to get you to pump up your arms and he's trying to get you to worship and he's trying to get you to come to church on time to actually participate, is he trying to get you? And do we put all the fire on him like, worship, I wasn't feeling it this morning. Holy Spirit wasn't present in this place today. Josh, you were off key, sorry. Bass player, he just didn't look happy up here, you know, like. Who are we putting it on here who lights the fire? Are we putting it on the worship team to light the fire underneath us? And we're putting the expectation on them that it's all about the worship team to light the fire? Are we putting it on the music? The style of music, the songs that are picked, was it my beat? Was it my jam? Was it not my beat? Was it not my rhythm? Was it not my style of music? And we put that on whether our fire gets lit or not. Do we put it on the pastor or the preacher? You know, preacher, you had a good word this morning. No, preacher, you just weren't landing. Sorry. You weren't landing the plane. Do we put it on the preacher to light the fire? Who lights the fire? Because I'm going to say that ultimately it should be the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit should be lighting the fire in your house. The Holy Spirit should be lighting the fire in you, which ultimately means that you can have the Holy Spirit not just in church. You can have the Holy Spirit outside. You can have the Holy Spirit at home. You can have the Holy Spirit at work. You can have the Holy Spirit in your car. You can have the Holy Spirit anywhere you are at, and he can light a fire for you. It should be the Holy Spirit who lights your fire. This is why Jesus tells us, and John the Baptist tells us, that it's Jesus who's going to come and bring the fire, that the Holy Spirit is going to baptize you with fire. Nadab and Abihu went rogue, and they did not do what God had commanded him. In their own strength, they put their fate in their own fire. When it comes to the altar of God that makes us acceptable to God, you can't light your own fire. It won't measure up. When it comes to getting into heaven, it is not in your strength, in your ability, in your works, in what you do that's ultimately going to make your offering acceptable to God. Nothing makes our offerings acceptable to God. Nothing we do makes our actions acceptable, our worship acceptable, our sacrifice acceptable, because it's not based on us. It is not our strength. It is not our fire. It is his fire that he lit, that they brought to him that made the offering acceptable. It is not in our fire. It is in the fire of God himself, which was the person of Jesus Christ who came down to offer himself as the perfect sacrifice. That's why when we do things in our own strength, it does not work. When we do things in our own power and our might, it does not work. We cannot get into heaven through our own actions, through our own good deeds, because ultimately we are disqualified, which is why we need his fire. We need Jesus to light the fire. We need Jesus to make the offering. We need Jesus to become the high priest. You see, with great influences comes great responsibility. With great influences come greater responsibility. If you're taking notes, you should write that down. With great influence comes great responsibility. It's interesting in this passage that right after Aaron lost his sons, Moses comes to Aaron and says, hey, you need to keep doing the job you're doing. And he's like, what do you mean I need to keep? He's like, you can't mourn your sons. Take their bodies outside the camp. Have some relatives do that. You need to keep doing what you're doing. And he tells them in verse 7, he says, do not leave the entrance of the tent of meeting or you will die, because the Lord's anointing oil is still on you. He says, you're still anointed. The people are looking. And if you start mourning, it sends them the wrong message. You just lost your sons. Moses, I just lost my sons. What are you talking about? He says, listen, if you start mourning, it sends the wrong message to the people, because you know that your sons did wrong. You know what they did. And God still needs to have the right message portrayed and communicated. We speak the truth in love. He said, the people are looking. In the Leviticus 10 and 11, it says, this is to be a lasting ordinance for the generations to come, so that you can distinguish between the holy and the common, between the unclean and clean, and so you can teach the Israelites all the decree the Lord has given them through Moses. He says, listen, your job is so important that you are to teach the people what is clean and unclean, what is right and what is wrong. And if you leave your post, even in your mourning, if you don't do what you're supposed to do, the people will be led astray. The people will lose sight. The people will lose faith. You have an important responsibility because you are a person of influence. That's what he tells Aaron. He says, even in your mourning, let me tell you something. One of the reasons why ministry is hard, and I don't just say ministry because I'm a pastor, I say ministry because we are all ministers here as we go out into the world. One of the reasons why ministry is hard is because we bear the weight of people's problems. We bear the weight of people's issues. We stand in the gap for people. And as we do that, sometimes we have to put our personal issues aside in order to be able to handle them publicly. Sometimes we have to put our things that we're going through aside, our personal issues aside, in order to stand in the gap for somebody else publicly, in order to show up, in order to be there for them. That's what Moses is telling Aaron, that with your position, it has such a great responsibility. The way that you act, the way that you handle yourself, the way that you address this situation is communicating to everyone else. Parents, the way that you live your life communicates to your children. Your children are going to learn not what you say, but in what you do. Your actions are teaching them. So if they see you reading your word, guess what? They'll want to read theirs. If they see you on your knees in prayer, they will want to pray. If you set up a routine over and over again where I'm living my life for God, they're going to learn that this isn't just a Sunday morning thing, that this is a relationship that I do all the time. Your actions matter. People are watching you. You are on display as a minister of God, as an ambassador of Christ before the world. The world is watching the church. And the church needs to start acting like Christ. Because we are being judged for our actions. We are being judged for our posts that we put on social media. We are being judged for the things that we do to each other, the lack of love that we show, the lack of compassion, the lack of grace, the lack of mercy. The world is judging us. And what God says is, they are going to judge you. They are watching you. So it's time. If you're going to be a person of influence, you have a responsibility. It's time to act like Christ. It's time to be like Jesus to the world. That is our calling, which is ultimately why Paul gives instructions to Timothy. Look at it in 1 Timothy 3. He says, here is a trustworthy saying. Whoever aspires to be an overseer, somebody of influence, somebody has responsibility, an overseer in the church, Desire is a noble task. Now the overseer is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him. And he must do so in a manner worthy of full respect. I wonder if we just stopped at verse 1 and just said, man, if everyone just practiced what it meant to be above reproach, if everyone in the church just practiced what it meant to be above reproach, that means that somebody can't come to you and tell you that you're doing something wrong. That means that somebody can't come to you and tell you that they saw what you were doing. It means that somebody can't come to you because you're going to be above reproach. Nobody's going to have anything ever against you because you are going to be above reproach. Nobody can ever find something on you because you are going to be. If the church started acting like this, I wonder if people in the world would want to be part of it. I wonder if people in the world would say, man, why are you so gracious? Why are you so loving? Why are you so compassionate? Why do you do everything with all of your might and all of your strength, like you're serving the Lord, like your last day and your life depends on it? Why? Because Jesus died for me. He gave it all for me. And because he's willing to do that, I'm willing to do everything for him. I'm going to live my life above reproach. I'm not going to live my life complacent. I'm not going to live my life relaxed. I'm not going to live it like this. Because why? Every decision matters. Distinctions matter because people are watching us. With great influence comes great responsibility. You see, Nadab and Abihu wanted to be the center of the entourage. They were the influencers of the day. And we see what happens often with celebrity culture. We see that sometimes I don't think people were meant to be as famous as they are. And when someone rises to fame, like many people do, something happens to them. It changes them. It transforms them. They become the center of the world, the center of their attention, and they need to stay at the top. And to desire that much influence, that much power, transforms them into something. It's very few that can continue to walk a Christian walk with having that much fame and influence. And God bless the ones who can, because I don't think we were ever meant to be famous like that. But the question goes, who's at the center of your world? Who is at the center? Because if you are at the center and your world revolves around you, then you are sitting on a throne that you were never meant to sit on. Am I preaching yet? Jesus is the one who's meant to be on the throne. Jesus is the one who is in control. Jesus is the one who is sovereign, who is over all things, which is why we have to get off the throne. The world does not revolve around us. We revolve around Jesus and what Jesus says. And what Jesus teaches, you see, a person of influence has great responsibility because you are in charge of the lives of the people around you. What you do matters. How you live matters. And you are either pointing someone toward Jesus or you're pointing them away from Jesus. You are either pointing someone to Christ or you're pointing someone towards Satan. What you do matters. The last point that I have for you is that it's interesting that after Aaron had been told to keep doing what he's doing, after Aaron was told not to mourn, after Aaron was told that he needs to continue to make the sacrifices, it's interesting that Aaron would have thought, well, wait a minute. Am I not disqualified? I just had two sons who ended up rebelling against God. I just had two close family members who ended up doing something stupid in the temple. So why am I still the high priest? Why am I still being called into this? And it's interesting that Moses, like, automatically just goes back into the repetition of, this is how you make the sacrifice. This is how you do it. This is what you're supposed to do. You think Aaron would have somehow had doubts. And what he teaches Aaron is a couple things. Number one is, you're not disqualified. You're not disqualified because of what your kids did. You see, if I was writing a book of the Bible, I would sit here and say, okay, you know what? This person, Aaron, you have a bad family line. You know what? You're out of the picture. I'm going to call another high priest. I'm going to get another guy with a beard. I'm going to get another guy with a suit. And you're going to come up here and you're going to do this instead. There's a whole bunch of people to choose from. And that's families not all messed up. And what we see in the Bible over and over again is that God chooses and uses different people who have dysfunctionality, who are messed up. And he uses them in order to display what he is doing in their lives. Aaron had two rebellious sons. David, who says sought after the Lord's heart, was a womanizer. Paul was a murderer. You see, if I was writing the story and choosing people, I would choose different people. But what it tells me is that God can use even me. God can use even me through my faults, my mistakes, my past. He can still use me and redeem all things. He says, Aaron, pick up your staff and continue to make sacrifices. Aaron, continue to stand in the gap. Aaron, continue to be the priest at the gate. Aaron, continue to minister to the people. I know that you're mourning. I know you just lost your kids, but this role is so important that you need to continue preaching the gospel that people are clean. Continue to show them that the divine is not angry with them. Continue to show them about my love and my compassion and my mercy, that when they sin, I forgive. Continue to illustrate. Continue to teach no matter what. That's why Isaiah tells us, you see, I have refined you, though not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of affliction. What's interesting here is that after Jesus Christ came, the fire that once consumed no longer consumed. The fire that once consumed now refines because of the blood of Jesus. You see, if the blood of Jesus covers over you, the consuming fire, because Abihu and Nadab grabbed their own fire, the unconsecrated fire, it consumed them. They lost their life. It burnt them up. But the consecrated fire is what God offers us. The consecrated fire is what Jesus offers us. That Jesus is a refining fire. That Jesus does not come to consume you or burn you up. Jesus comes in order to refine you and make you pure, make you good, make you like him. Jesus comes in order to cover over our sin. Jesus, the one who had no sin, went outside the camp and was consumed for all of our sins. Jesus was consumed by the fire. Jesus lost his life and was consumed. So we don't have to be. We no longer have to be concerned about being consumed, because ultimately we're being refined. This is why Jesus says, those who are weary, those who are hurting, those who are lost, can come to me. And I will be the one to give you rest. Because ultimately it's him who had to pay the price and be consumed by the Lord's anger and wrath. He was the one on the cross who took all of God's anger so we don't have to. Jesus paid the price and was consumed so we can now be refined to be like him. So Aaron going through the process of continuing to make the sacrifices, of continuing to offer up the fire, continuing to offer up the consecrated fire to burn, learned something in the process, I believe. I think he learned that even in his mourning, even in his hurting, because I can't imagine a parent who loses their children in a catastrophe, in a split second of them just being dumb or stupid. I can't imagine the pain. But I think Aaron learned something along the way. Not judging the kids, because kids will be kids and kids will do dumb things. We all do as people. That's humanity. We all make mistakes. We all mess up. But in that moment, as a parent, in his grief, in his hurting, in his suffering, he continues to make sacrifices. He continues to worship. That's what he does. He offers worship over and over and over again to the Lord. And in that worship, he's experiencing something. He's experiencing grace. He's experiencing mercy. He's experiencing compassion. He's seeing God's forgiveness. And worship is what is healing him. You see, it's through our worship. In your grief, we worship God. In your grief, we should worship God. When we're hurting, when we're suffering, Jesus says you can bring all of your pain, all of your suffering, everything to me, and I will give you peace. I will give you rest. I will heal your soul for the weary. It's in your worship. When Moses inquired about the goat of the sin offering and found that it had been burnt up, he was angry with Eleazar and Ithamar, Aaron's remaining sons, and asked, "Why didn't you eat the sin offering in the sanctuary area? It is most holy. It is given to you to take away the guilt of the community by making atonement for them before the Lord." So Moses says, "Why didn't you eat the sin offering here? This is the holy spot to do it." They said, "Well, because we're hurting, we're suffering, we just lost our brother. We lost our appetite. We couldn't eat Moses. We couldn't go through the process." And when he'd heard that explanation, it says he was satisfied. Because Aaron turned to him and said, they still did their role. They still made the sacrifices. They still did it just because they couldn't eat because of their mourning. And they were hurting, and it shows that they were hurting. And in our grief, in our pain, what is going to be our response? Should be to worship. Should be to come to Jesus. It should be come and keep going through the motions. Because when we go through the motions, God will give us the right heart. When we go through the actions, God will transform and change our heart. He will give us that consuming fire within. I want to ask for you to bow your heads. Because maybe there's somebody here who realizes that they need a brand new heart. Maybe there's somebody here who needs the fire of the Lord to ignite their soul. Maybe there's somebody here who needs the fire to be extended and offered to you. It doesn't come through anything else but prayer. It doesn't come from anyone else but the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that he was raised from the dead, you will be saved. The fire will be over you. It will not consume you. It will not destroy you. It will refine you. to make you like his son, Jesus. We have to confess with our mouth and believe in our heart. If there's anybody who wants to do that this morning, I just want to pray with you. Just pray this prayer with me. There's nothing magical about these words. It's just an honest confession. Father, I know that I'm a sinner. I know I don't deserve your grace. I know I don't deserve your mercy. But I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. And I believe your son was raised from the dead. And I want you to transform my heart. I want you to give me a new passion. I want you to give me a new fire. I want you to give me a new way of life. I want you to give me a new desire to serve and to love and pursue you. So come into my life, Lord, and lead me and guide me. In Jesus Christ's name, I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, amen. We can clap. It's okay. We're not clapping for anybody but God and what he does. If you prayed that prayer, I just want to stand up here and tell you, you have been made clean. That God covers over all of your sins. Even in our pain, he is not hurting us. He is helping us. He is refining us. He is molding us, and he is shaping us. And we can take all of our hurts to him. And so I'm going to ask for some of our prayer warriors to come up front. And as we stand up and sing this final song, if you have any prayers that you want our prayer warriors to pray on behalf of you, anything you want to bring before the Lord, we stand in the gap for you in order to pray over you and with you. Let's praise.
All my life. All my life you have been faithful. All my life.
All my life you have been so.
Every breath that I am.
It's my prayer as we leave this place that as we sing this song, it's not just a song that you sing, but you show people the goodness of God in the way that we live every single day. Because the world is watching, and we are Christ's ambassadors and representatives here on this earth. So let's show them that God is working inside of our hearts, that He is showing us what to show to them, that He is giving us grace and mercy in order to give it away to them, that He is blessing us in order to be a blessing to others. Let's show people that God is good. Amen. If you're new this morning, amen. If you're new this morning, I want to invite you to stick around after the service. We have some groups that meet during the week. We've been going through the book of Leviticus in order to be able to show how Leviticus points toward the gospel, the good news of Jesus. It's not a book that many churches or many people read, but it's a book that we believe is all about Jesus. If you're joining us with Power Track because you want to become a member, week one starts today. And let me just send you away with God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord turn His face toward you and give you His amazing peace. Amen. Amen. Go in peace. Have a great week.